Hello, how are you doing?
Good, how are you?
I'm good, thank you. Welcome back from spring break. I hope you had a good spring break. Okay, so today we're going to go over the next unit, chapter 9 and 10. So we're going to talk a little bit more about trap. So take a look at the assignment for today in the notes. We'll have about a minute, so. And then as we are at the end, when we have time, we'll talk about the project. I'll go over a little bit about the project and what's expected of you in this project. So, okay. Let's share screen. I'll have the video posted either tonight or tomorrow. When you look at Canvas, you can take a look at the project. It's after the unit. Will be at the end of the Canvas modules. I'll go over this at the end of the session today. Okay, so it is 6 o'clock. We're gonna go ahead and get started. So for today, we're going to talk a little bit about stack and trap. I think we talked about pseudo operations and instructions in the past. We're going to expand a little bit on the trap vector. And we're going to talk a little bit about system call and how that is. As part of the project, you will be expected to write a stack in assembly. So we want to make sure that you know how to do that. And you're going to see some of that in the lab. Okay, so let's take a look at the notes first. So as I mentioned, this week we're going to talk about chapter 9 and 10. And the focus in this in these chapters, for chapter 9, it's going to be trap and subroutine. We learned in the past that when we write a subroutine in assembly, basically it is a function. And you can jump to subroutine, and that's how you issue a function call. And you would do that accordingly. So to really define what a system call would be, that would be a specific operation or an action that you want that IO or input-output device to do. For example, we talked about input-output, input from the keyboard. It will wait for the signal for the character to be striked. So in that sense, when you issue an in or a get C, that generate a system call. And with that, it needs to take a look at how the system resources are used, especially the input and output devices. So for the service routines or the system call, as you know, this is considered part of the operating system. And an operating system simply is a software that interfaces the user to the hardware. So, for example, if we're using Windows 10 or 11, that's an operating system, or Mac OS, or Android, or iOS. It's the way that we can interact with the hardware. Now, within the operating system, it has the functionality to control the service routines or the system call. And it separates that into two areas. One is going to be the user, the other is going to be the system. And in your textbook, it talks about how this is going to be low-level privileged operations. So when you're looking at the privileged operations, that's really a system control environment. That means that we as user do not have interaction, but it's going to be just the device being controlled within the system itself. So the operating system would then take control of the computer, or what you would see as computer components, right? Your microprocessor or your storage. And it's going to be able to handle different instructions and what we see in LC3 that will be trapped. And each of the trap with the specific vector is going to be tied to certain service routine that's related to the input and output devices, as we talked about that in the past. So once the service request is being handled, it's then going to return to the actual program or the software. And it's using a specific location, and this is what we're going to talk a little bit about later. That's going to be part of the stack. So there's a register, which is register 7, that's going to keep track of where it's going to pick up from the program. So when you write your code, let's say you write a few lines and you would have a service routine like in for an input. At that point, what you're going to see is that you're going to have a service call for the input, and it's going to wait for the keyboard to be struck with the character. Once that's already been fulfilled, it's going to go back to the next line of your code, which is it's going to pick up from your program, from the program counter, which is the address that's going to be stored into register 7. And we're going to talk a little bit about this, right? And it's going to be from the location hex 4001. So in this example, is just what I just iterate was the user program invoke a system call like in or out. The operating system code performs the operation. At the low level, it's going to use the service call for the input and output. So that way the hardware, right, your monitor or your keyboard is going to be able to get serviced through that service call. Then after that, it's going to use an address to be able to return to your program, and it's going to pick up where it's left off. And in LC3, we use trap. So for every assembly language, it's going to use a certain mechanism that's going to handle the service call or the system call, and that's through the operating system. So now let's answer some questions. For number one, it asks you to describe the importance of system service at the low-level functions. We can say that certain privileged service requires specialized knowledge and protection. And so for the system or in the operating system, what it does is it's going to handle specific I/O devices through the registers. We talked about how we would use KBR or keyboard register, right? Or for the monitor, the DSR. So what you would see is that there are specific registers that are dedicated to the input and output for the hardware. And that's going to be utilized in the privilege operation that's only going to be handled by the system, right? And that's in the system mode. So if you ever took operating system class, they're going to talk about how the operating system is designed in two separate areas. One is going to be for privilege operation, which is the system mode. And the second area is going to be the user mode, which is how we can interact. We can have input and output. We can be able to manage our file for the operating system itself. So in the system mode is where our privilege operation exists. And so in that sense, what you would see is that the sequence of operations is then needed to be used for your service call for input and output. So when I'm saving a file to my storage, for example, my hard drive or my solid state drive, it is considered an I/O process. So what that does is going to access it at the privilege operations, and it's going to bring it from the user mode into the system mode. Once the user selected and clicked the save, the privilege operation is going to handle the writing of the data into the storage. And that's still a form of input. And then when we open file and to display the file, that's a form of output. And so it's going to be able to operate from the privilege or the system mode and then bring it forward to the user mode. So that way the user can see the file being opened. So in that sense, what you see is your I/O resources is actually shared in across for the program, right? We talked about how it's going to be interacting between the system mode and the user mode, the privilege operations, and considerably the user control operations. And so if you have issues with I/O resource control, what's going to happen is the user is not going to be able to interact with the program, or the user would have to wait for a specific process to be done, and that can cause a lot of issues. And so this is carry across. So when you're looking at like server operations down to desktop operations or even applications, right? You have to really think about how things are being handled on a low level as a service call. And that gets translated from, or it gets integrated from the system mode into the user mode where we as the user would be able to interact with the system. Any question? Okay, so the answer for this you would find on the first page of our notes, right? The first section. And so let's talk a little bit about trap mechanism. So we learned that in LC3, when we deal with I/O or when we deal with pseudo operations with the service call, we would see that we would have trap. And it is an instruction on how to handle specific tasks. So when you issue a trap or when you look at your simulator and you see trap, this is a service routine. And it's going to start with an arbitrary address, right? Not necessarily going to be exactly at a certain region of the memory. Sometime it would be at hex 000, or it could be at another area. And so the arbitrary section of the address or the table of the addresses for the trap, this is considered a system control block in certain architecture, right? Like if you're looking at another microprocessor type, this region of the address at the beginning before the hex 3000 where our program normally starts, this is part of the system control block. And it uses this region of the address for service routine or your system call in general. And so this is why when we use save and restore register, we would use arbitrary address or this type of address so that way we would be able to handle something that's temporary. So when you issue the trap, what's going to happen is when you look at the instruction, it's very similar to the other instruction like load and store, where you would use your 8-bit right here to specify the vector type, right? So how can it differentiate between in and out or get C, right? Or and puts. This area, these 8 bits here will differentiate between one instruction to the next or the pseudo instruction to the next. And so it would use the 8-bit trap vector, and the specific value is dedicated for a certain type of pseudo instruction. And so that's going to be able to handle 256 different type of service routines, where if you're looking at the combinations of the 8 bits in variation, we would be able to have 256 service routines. And so after the system call is fulfilled, your program is then going to resume immediately after the trap instruction. So when you look at the simulator, when you get to that pseudo instruction like out or puts, if you look on the right-hand side after the program is executed, you're going to see trap. And you're going to see the value, or in binary, it's going to specify the vector type here. And then you're going to see register 7 being used, because register 7 is going to handle, right, the address from the PC. And we're going to talk about that next. So here it talks about where to go. So it's going to look at the table of addresses, and it's going to start at hex 0000. And it's going to end at hex 00FF. So this is the region where it would use specifically for system call to invoke your 8-bit index for a specific vector with trap. So once it look up that address, it's going to take that address and put it into the program counter. And it's going to use that to find the vector value. Once the system call is fulfilled, it's going to use register 7. And register 7 is in charge of where the program currently is, right? Which is the next line of your code, the next instruction. It's going to have the address of that next instruction, so that way it's going to pick it up where it's left off. So that's how it's able to get back. And that's how your program will be able to continue. And so to simulate this, that's the flow we would see, right? Your program counter, that address is then transferred to register 7. And then your instruction with the trap, that's going to put into your MAR. It's going to use the MAR to find the region of the memory. And we talked about your service call region. And that gets transferred to the MDR, so it sees that as a data. Okay. And similarly, this is what you see with the return instruction. So when you return from a function at C++ level, right, which is a higher level, which is equivalent to what you do with the jump subroutine and then a return from that subroutine. So what you see is you would see the program counter address being saved to register 7. It's going to jump to register 7. To be able to pick up where that program is left off. Okay. So for number 2, it asks you what happens after the system or the service call is initiated. So when that system call is initiated in the program, this is where we start right here. The user program invoked the system call at the application level. Then the OS, the operating system, is going to perform the operation. And through that, we talked about what is being handled in the privilege operation with the system mode, right? So the OS is going to take that from the user mode into the system mode, and it's going to handle, right, the IO service call. Then once that's done, it's going to return the control back to the user program. So it's going to take it from the privilege or the system mode, and it's going to bring it back to the user mode. And in the user program, this is where your program counter address is then being used from the register to pick up where it's left off. Then for question three, it asks you, what is the purpose of the trap vector in the service routine? Trap is a service routine that is used to transfer the control to the OS. This is a specific instruction to be able to allow the OS to access then that specific operation in its privileged mode. So it is used for specific operation. Any question? And so in the case where if you have an instruction get C and you prompt the user to, prior to that, you will prompt the user to input a character, but the user doesn't strike the keyboard. We talked about how it's always going to wait for that signal. So in that sense, your operating system is going to wait for that service request to be fulfilled, right? It fulfills it through allowing the keyboard to listen for that signal. But if the user doesn't strike any key on the keyboard, what's going to happen is that is always going to be pending, right? It's always going to wait for that signal. So your program will never return to its next instruction until the keyboard is strike. Right? So it's never going to pick up to go back to the PC address or the program counter address for the next instruction. It's just going to be there. Okay. So in the case where if you're writing a program that's looping, right, and that's prompting the user and it's keep prompting the user, and if there's no user to type in the input, it's just going to be there and that service call never gets fulfilled. So the OS doesn't release it back to the user mode or the user program. And as we mentioned a little bit about trap and return previously, number four asks you to describe the process that involved trap when RET instruction is issued in LC3. And RET is equivalent to return, right, from what you see in C-based programming language. So that's considered equivalent to a jump R7. So that's a jump instruction with the register 7. That allows us to get back to the program, right, to the right spot because it uses the program counter address. And in LC3, we would use return in place of jump R7. So it's equivalent to jump R7. So when you use RET in your code at the end of your subroutine, you would see that on the simulator, it might show jump R7 there, right? So it's just gonna go to, right, the address that's stored in register 7. Any question? So make sure that we know the mechanism for trap. We understand how to use return instruction and what's involved with return instruction. You will see some of this on the final exam and the next quiz. Okay, so on page 2, it gives you the illustration of return, right? So here's my user program. That will be my code from the beginning to end. And somewhere right here, I have an RET. So it's gonna go to my control block, which is the region of the address for the system call, right? It's gonna be able to have the information for the system call here because it's a trap. Then It's going to fulfill the service routine through that address. So it's using that address to be able to go to the service routine, basically. And then after it fulfills the service routine, it's going to use the program counter and it's going to pick back up. So this is where your register 7 jump. It's going to jump to R7 right here. And then it's going to continue with the rest of the program. So when we use the pseudo instruction like in, out, put, get, see, you would see that it is a trap with the vector, right? Like this is trap hex 23. So when it simulates, it's going to show trap at that location for your instruction for input, for output, and for halt. So when you write halt, right, basically it's a trap hex 25 or vector 25. And then for the next part, this shows you how this is for your service routine. And at the low level, this is how they write it. Right, we would use a system call address. Remember, we talked about this origination address is a little different than what we normally originate in our regular program. So we would start in that region, hex 0000, between that and hex 00FF. So it's going to originate here. And we have to store the register 7. And register 1, because register 1 is used for the update of the status of the IO. So this is how it's going to write the character and then return from trap. And then again, I give you the table for the vector for trap. Any question regarding trap? And then we're going to go to save and restore. So in the last lab, we have worked on save and restore register, right? And I asked you to write down some information about that in your lab. So we want to emphasize a little bit more on the reason why we save and restore register and what's happening when we do that. Okay. So when should I save and restore register? You would save and restore when we know that the value might be destroyed or will be destroyed by the service routine. So that means that my data can change or deleted or override if, you know, for the next few instructions. So that means that we have to save it. And when we save it, all that does is we are going to put it into a location of memory temporarily and then retrieve it later for use. So that means that we will need to use it for some kind of action later. And you see this with loops, you see this with, you know, functions that you're returning values from, recursive functions, things like that for our sequence or continuous action that we need to do for computation. So when we save, the caller of the service routine would need to know the value for later use. And we want to save this so that way it's not altered or modified. And for the call service routine, it would know what to be altered But then when we need to call it later, it's gonna go and retrieve the appropriate data. So the process for this, when you save and restore, okay, you can use register, but in this way, what you see is that we would use the label, actual memory location. So when you see this here, it's going to store the number and it's going to use the pointer, increment the pointer, and it's going to branch. So that way it's going to go back to again, which is back here to obtain the character, right? So this is a way that we can get the user to input and ASCII convert it. And we're going to keep doing that 10 times, okay? Now, as you loop through each time, you want to be able to save it each time. Because if you don't, you're going to lose the value. So that means that I have to make sure that it goes somewhere and it saves it. And then later I can read from it. So that way I can compute it. Okay. So in this code, what you see is that it's going to loop back to again, right, as it counts down until it reaches zero. And then when it gets to zero, it's going to go to next, which is the next part of the code. But as it does that, we want it to ASCII convert each of the character that's inputted and save it. So for the criteria for save register, we must save the value if it might be destroyed by service routine. And if we need to use it for later action. So the primary difference between the call routine and the calling routine. For the call routine, before the start, it would save any registers that might be altered. That's for the call routine. So this is why when you look at the code from last lab, right, we save the register before our routine. And before we return, make sure we remember to do this for our project, we would restore from the same register. So that means that when you put it in a memory location, you would save it there. Later on, you would need to go and read it. So that means that you would need to load it. Okay, so if you store it at the beginning, that means you write to that memory location. Before you return, you need to go and read it so that way you would have the value so you can return that value. Okay, that's important. Now, comparing that to the calling routine, save register destroyed by its own instruction. Okay. If the values needed later, save are 7 before the trap. So if you're using calling routine, you would need it, you know that it's going to be destroyed. So you're going to use register 7 before any kind of trap. Because trap is a system call. And you want to save it before the system call. Okay. So in the case, if we're using an input value like trap vector 23, we want to save register 7 before the trap. And we want to save register 0. Why register 0 is because that's where the input value comes from, right? When I type in like a character that for get C or in, it comes from register zero. So you need to save register zero for trap vector 23 or any form of input. Okay. Otherwise, we're going to lose it. So normally I would tell the student, copy it to another register and then save that register. Because if you don't, if you have the next input, it's going to override that next input. So you need to make sure that you copy it to the register, another register, and then save that register. So make sure that we look at when trap happens and we want to save register before that. Any questions? Okay, and then the third thing is that you want to avoid using register 7 and 0 in general. So when we do a lot of the operation or calculation, let's say that you want to compute X plus Y, right? We normally take the input from register 0 and then we would copy it to register 1 or another register for X and then register 2 for Y. So we would make register 0 be available, especially for the trap mechanism. Plus, we don't want to alter any other additional input and output. So just to, in general, should avoid it. You can use it, but just keep in mind that what you're modifying or what's currently in that register and what's coming into that register. You have to think about that when you think about the use of that register. Okay, so let's talk about jump to subroutine again. I think we talked about this last time. So the callee and the caller, you can find that on the top of page 3. So I wanted to make a clarification to make sure that we distinguish between JSR and JSRR. And you've seen JSR being used in our lab already. So this is a way that we would call a function or jump to subroutine. And the opcode for this is in binary is 0100. And that's going to go here for the first 4 bits. And it's going to put the return address to register 7 because this is for a function. And for the starting address of the function or the subroutine, that's where it's going to load. So when you define that label, let's say function 1, and you would have like add R1. R10, etc. That address for that instruction, the beginning of the definition of your function or your subroutine is going to load to the program counter, and that's where it's going to know. So in C++, when you define a function, you would say int, right? Get value, that will be your function name, and then you would define the body of the function. The compiler is going to have the starting address of your function definition. It's going to load it so that way it knows what is the content of your function and what, so that way when it compiles it, it knows what to do. And the return address is then put into a register. And in our case for LC3, it's register 7. It's then going to increment in the program counter so that way it's going to point to the JSR or how it's going to be able to jump to the subroutine. So in the instruction itself, it looks at the target address of the subroutine, which is what we talked about. That's the body of your function. It's going to then sign extend and it's going to use the offset, which is the 11 bits back here from bit 0 to bit 10. And it's going to use that to be able to operate it as an address mode, very similar to what you see with read and write or load and store. Okay. However, in following the JSR, it's going to be stored at location hex 4200. So whenever that you see the 4000, you normally see that this is a region of memory, and we normally use this for stack. So with the compiler in C++, what you see is when you have a function, you define a function, you call that function. As that function is called, it's going to push it onto the stack, which is it's going to take the address of that and it's going to place it into a region of memory that's dedicated for stack. And this is normally the region that we see in LC3, which is the 4000. And this is where the execution happens, because the program counter is going to be then loaded with a specific value, but the register 7 is going to be loaded with the increment of 1. Why 1 is because it's the next instruction, and that's the first line of your code, your instruction in your function definition to be able to execute your function or your subroutine. Okay. So if you notice that this 1 right here, right? It's going to be where that's going to be located, and the offset is going to be the address computation for your function definition. And so the next time you run your C++ program, right, when you see that function being executed, you would understand at the low level, it is a jump to the subroutine where it placed, right, the address of your function definition and increment by 1 onto the stack, which is a region memory that's dedicated specifically for the subroutine and other things, but we'll talk about stack shortly. Then for the JSRR, it's going to fulfill the same goal as JSR. But the difference between JSRR and JSR is that it is in address mode. So it's going to start the same way as JSR, where it's going to have a starting address of your subroutine, which is where your function is defined or stored. So it's going to use a jump instruction and go there. Now, when you look at JSRR, it's slightly different because it does not use the offset like JSR. So it's going to use the base register and the rest of the bits here, and the way that it's loading the addresses is different. So the mechanism with the JSR, with how it uses address mode, is different than JSR. Okay. So let's answer that next part. So I highlighted in yellow, right? So the true difference between these two that you would see is that it computes for JSR. It's going to compute the target address with the subroutine by sign extended the 11-bit offset. JSRR compute the target address, but it does not use the 11-bit offset. For the JSRR, it's exactly like that at the beginning, but it's going to use the address mode. That means that it's going to use the base register with the rest of the bits for the address mode for the subroutine. Okay, so JSR uses 11-bit PC offset. JSRR uses address mode with the base register. And often we would use JSR to call our function or jump to the subroutine. What this is what you normally see with our lab, right? And so the use of addresses between these two are different. Ultimately, if we want to summarize it into one sentence, that's basically it. And so you can find the answer. I know some of you are typing this out, but all of this is in your notes, right? Right here. Bottom of page 5 and going to the top of page 6. Any question? So I think we mentioned this a while back also. Before spring break, we talk about how you can incorporate libraries, right? Like you would see in programming language like Java, Python, for C++, it's include, and then you can use a .h file or an STL, right? In Python, you can get the package and you can do an import, similarly with Java. So in assembly, we talk about how you can integrate external. So when you use .external, what that does is it's going to know that you are linking another file, basically. And you're going to use that to be able to incorporate with your program. And in some cases, we would have routines or subroutines, like we would be able to use a file that has functions and we can call those functions from those files in our main program. And you can do that, right? Why we do the work when someone, you know, you found a file that already has that. So you can incorporate library and to be able to interface. I think when I taught the Java class, right, we will be able to look at class interfaces and then use the member functions to be able to, you know, work throughout the modules and inside the package for modular design or with the OOP. So similarly, you would see with assembly is that we can incorporate another file and that's considered an external file. Now you got to make sure that those files that you are linking to this program and it's using, if you're using routines from those files, make sure that your main program sees it. So I would recommend that you put it in the same folder or put in a path. Normally, if you use assembly language that you see compiler like Visual Studio, you have to make sure that you configure the link for your external files. Okay. All right. So next we're going to talk about chapter 10, and chapter 10 focuses on stack. Okay. We're going to also revisit it in a future session as well. But for this, I want to make sure that you understand what stack is. So it's important across all programming language, I think. Especially when you're dealing with compiler, okay, like compiler-based program like C, C++. So stack is simply a region of memory that's used to store specific thing for operations. And for stack, it uses last in, first out. So imagine if you're stacking your dishes, right? The last dish that you have or wash, it's gonna go on top. And so as you remove that dish, it's gonna be the first one to leave. So the last one that comes in is gonna be the first one that goes out, LIFO. So the last thing that you put on the stack is the first thing that you remove. And that is the mechanism. So this is an abstract way of us to deal with storage for operations, like functions. So when you have a function call, what all that does is your variables and everything, the content of the function is in that region of memory, which is the stack, right, for execution. And we just touch on that on how we would look at the jump subroutine. So an analogy of this is like your coin holder. Right, you press it down as you add each coin. So the last coin that's added is going to be on top, which is the first one that you're going to remove. But this is just an abstract way of looking at things, right? Do we really push the things down? So the stack grows downward, and this is just an abstract way of us thinking on how things are stored. But technically, your data doesn't move around in memory. Okay? We just create an order on how the data is accessed and removed, or how the data is added and removed from that region of memory. So is it really the first coin here, is it really moving down the stack? No, it's not moving anywhere. It's just the order of it changes as we add more coins onto the stack or more data onto the stack. Okay? And the operation for this is to push. So as you add the item, that means you're going to push it into the stack. And when you remove an item, you're going to pop it from the stack. So how do we implement this in LC3? We would use registers to be able to point to the area of the stack that's top, right? Like I said before, the data doesn't really move in different addresses as you add more. So let's say that I have one, and then I add the second one and the third one and the fourth one. So it's supposed to grow downward. So the 195 is going right here, right? And 196 is at the top. So the way that we would use it to be able to track which one is the last one that gets pushed in is to point to it, to use a register and indicate that the 1996 is the last one that came in, because physically it doesn't really move around. It's just a way of us pointing and changing the pointer to different location as we add more or we push more items. So here it talks about that, to use a stack pointer to keep track of your stack as the elements or the items are pushed in. And the data doesn't physically move. And you have to keep in mind also that your memory is dynamically writing, right? We don't put things in order because that would take a lot of time. So as it places data, it is a region of memory and it would increment. But keep in mind that a lot of the times your data is going to go in as where is it is available. So the stack pointer simply is going to be able to point to the address that is going to be the last one in, which is going to be push in. And that's going to be the first one that's going to leave. So we can use a stack pointer to be able to pop that last one that comes in. And so this, the illustration for this is like this. You have number 18 that comes in first. And as you add more, right, it doesn't necessarily be exactly at that same location, right? It's just going to point to the number 12 as the last one that comes, that got pushed in after the three elements got pushed. And that will be the last one to leave. So when I pop, I can use my stack pointer to pop 12. And then after that, it's the stack pointer is going to move to the next one, which is 5. And then I can pop that. And then once I pop 5, then the pointer is going to move to 31, and I can pop that and so on. So the top is going to change as you pop, right, your item from your stack. So we have to visualize this as we need to write the stack. And we need to understand the mechanism of that, where we'll use a register to put the address of the next, the element that's at the top. Okay. Any question? All right. So for 8, describe how the stack is accessed in application. It uses LIFO, which is last thing that you store is the first thing that you remove, last in, first out. And the last thing that you put is the first thing that you take out. The two operations for stack, we talked about push and pop. And you see a lot of this being also utilized for, you know, data structure and storage container. Especially, you know, if you're familiar with Python or even with some of the functions with C++ STL, right? For vector container in C++, we also do push pop. So the idea of this is very commonly applied in a lot of the storage allocation for higher programming language. So the two operation is push and pop. And push is to add an item onto the stack. We push them onto the stack. And pop is when we remove an item from the stack, we pop an element from stack. So that brings us to the next part, which is our stack pointer, your TOS. This is in LC3, a register, and we would use that to track the top of the stack or the growth of the stack when the item gets pushed. And so in that case, we would see that TOS moves closer to 0. As you know that the stack grows downward, right? Like if you visualize the coin holder as what we see in the notes. And so in this case, we also need to check for underflow. That means that when we remove too many items from the stack, we might suffer from underflow. So we want to check, especially in the pop operation. And you would use TOS to check for what's on your stack, right? What's the top of your stack? And if you pop too many, you might suffer from underflow, which is the second piece there for number 10. So for 11, how can you prevent underflow and overflow? So overflows means that we add too many onto the stack. We push too many. And there's also a limitation to the region as well, right? Just like anything, it is a location where we store things. So if we have too many items inserted or pushed, you will have overflow. If you have too many items that are popped continuously, you would have an underflow. So we would use TOS before push or pop. You would use that register to check how much or how many items in your stack before you push or you pop. So think of it like a meter, right? We want to check our meter to see our stack meter. That's our TOS. Top of stack pointer. So make sure we know what this is for our quiz three and our final exam. You will definitely get questions on stack for finals. Any question? Okay. So for more explanations and example, right? And you're gonna see some of this in the lab this week and future week. We're almost done with all the lab. And I'll talk about the project after this. So we should finish with more time to talk about the project. And so here on page 8, you would see an example of push pop in LC3. Normally, we would use R6 as our stack pointer. Remember, we just talked about TOS, right? And you would decree, right? Remember, you have to visualize this, right? As you push down, when you push down, you would do a negative one here that's going to go down one, okay? Move down one. And then you store the data, register zero, okay? Then when you pop, as you str here in the push, you're going to do an LDR in the pop, the opposite. So you're going to load data, okay, from your TOS, okay, to register zero. And then you're going to move it back up one. So as you pop it, you got to move up one. As you push, you move down one, okay? So at the low level, that's how you do it. Minus one for the push, plus one for the pop. And so when we need to detect underflow, we need to make sure that we check register six or RTOS. Okay. And so when before we remove data, before we pop, we want to use a register, register five, for our status code. So here's a section for pop, right? And empty, we're gonna fill it with hex negative 4,000 because it's gonna grow down to 4,000. And we want to be able to, this is our pointer, right? We want to add, assuming that the register one has the address, so we would compute that here and put it on register two. And to compare, simply you're gonna take register one, which is 4,000, and if R6 is 4,000 subtract negative 4,000, it should be at zero here. And that's how you can compare. So if it's empty, it's negative hex 4,000. If it's full, it's 4,000. So when you compare, right, if it branches zero, then it's a fail. R5 is a one. If register five is a zero, then it's a success. So you would do, you would load zero to register six, which assume that's at the stack hex 4,000, and put it on register zero. You would increment one, and then you would and register five with a zero. So if it's a success, if it's returning, if it's a zero, then we're gonna return. That means that we can pop, okay? So in this case, what we would use is register five is gonna be a way that we can check for underflow or or success. Okay, so I would take a look at this and see how I can implement it in my project when I am required to do push and pop and check for underflow. Okay. Any question? Okay, and you will also see example in our lab. And then you can also do the same thing when you push, right? You fill it with an address, you do the comparison for the stack. As you push in, subtract one, add it to register six, and then we will be able to check the status by using another register. So I think we talked about polling and interrupt before, but we're going to revisit a little bit about interrupt-driven I/O today. So an interrupt is a subroutine call, but it is also going to trigger a system call. So in the case where you can generate some form of signal externally to be able to service, so for example, right, I can press combination key on my keyboard to halt, right, certain application. In Windows case, it's Control Alt Delete. And what that does is stop a certain execution of, you know, so we can kill a certain process through the task manager. And in some cases, in such cases, you actually generate an external signal for interrupt. And when that happens, your processor, it saved the state of what it's in, and it's going to start that service routine for that interrupt. And once it fulfills that, it's going to restore the state and resume the program. So it's going to pick up where it's left off because it's going to go to that safe state and it's going to be able to resume. Okay. So when there's a generated interrupt for input and output, that's what happens. It is going to still services as a subroutine call. And it's going to pick up where it's left off at the low level. So as far as the state, basically, it is the content of the program. And for us at the low level, when we see this, it is your program counter address that it's going to refer to. What it does is going to use the PC and the PSR. The PC contains the address of the next instruction where it can resume in the program, but the PSR is the status register for the processor. This is, but think of it like a file or a location for storage that is going to be used for its status, just for the processor itself. And so with the processor state, what does it really save? It's running process. And we know that in our program, if you have, you know, Windows or Mac OS or whatever, or Linux, you can even look at the type of process that are running, because as soon as you start your computer, you already have a lot of different services like internet connection, wireless connection, certain application that you're running. Sometimes you might have security software that launch at the start. So you have a lot of start services. So you already have, and even your operating system already have many processes that's involved. And so when you have an interrupt, what happens is it's going to focus its attention on that interrupt signal. So it has to resume in, you know, the program itself at some point after it fulfilled that interrupt request. So it's going to use the PC to go back to where it was. And it's going to use the PSR to take a look at the state of the process or the processes that are running at that point in time. Okay. Any question? Okay. So for 12, it asks you, why is processor state important when working with I/O interrupts? Because it provides a complete capture of the running process. When I/O interrupt occurs, it uses the status to resume in the program. And without that, it would not be able to pick up or return to state. And in some cases, you do see where you have interrupt that will cause issues and it cannot resume. That's just a flaw in the program design itself. So any question? So if you think about malware, right? Some malware operates at low level where it generates system call continuously. And that way it just take up resources. So the processor would just have to be able to fulfill those type of requests and not be able to allow it to return to the normal processes for applications and other things. You do see a lot of that, right? Generating some form of service contact to external server and keep fulfilling that. So it keeps generating that particular service request through the OS. And at the hardware level, that's just a lot of system call that's just continuously going. And you know, whether they write it in higher programming language or low level programming language, that can be achieved, right? Ultimately, it's just a code for malicious intention. So all right, so next we're going to talk about supervisor stack. And then we only have a few more things to go. So let's continue. So here it talks about where your processor state can be saved. And in the past, it talks about register. It's just a temporary location, right? I always tell you at the beginning, registers don't store anything permanently. We have to put it to a memory address in order to keep it permanent. Okay, so in that case, when you can't use register, a lot of the time you would have issues with not knowing that the interrupt occurred. And on also, you have to restore the state of how it was before the interrupt occurred. Okay. So one of the important rules about your service routine is that you need to save the state when for invoking. And some of these things, I listed the sequential order on how it would be able to look at what state can be saved, where is it going to go, right, and how it branches. So based on this, you can generate a procedure on how you can implement the algorithm for your interrupt service routine, actually. Okay. So the solution for this would be to use a stack, right? The location for the stack, we already said that we know that it's in the hex 4000. That's generally the practice for the stack location. We push a state to save and we pop to restore. And so when you use a stack for interrupted program, it would be able to go to that location as it push on to save the state of it, and then it comes back when it pops it off. Okay. So that brings us to the supervisor stack. This is a region of memory that's used as stack for interrupt service routine. So if the solution is to use a stack, supervisor stack is the answer for interrupted service routines. And this is a dedicated section just specifically for that. We would use a register to point to what's on top of that stack. And as I mentioned before, when you look at this, you have to think about the user stack and your supervisor stack. Okay. So the user stack is for user programs. The supervisor stack is a privileged dedicated location. It uses the stack pointer specifically to be able to access the user stack after the interrupt is fulfilled. So for 13, we need to describe supervisor stack. And we need to compare that to the user stack. So for 13, we can say that supervisor stack is the region of memory that's used for stack for interrupt service routine. It's used only by the program that executed in the privilege mode, not the user stack and the user mode. The different location in memory for interrupt service routine, and it's only being executed in privilege mode. Any question? So just like other subroutine, we can return. And so for the RTI, return to interrupt instruction, this allows us to, or the system to use the supervisor mode and to be executed in the privileged mode. And it will never use the user mode because that's going to cause an error or an exception. Okay. So here on page 11, the middle of the page, it talks about return for interrupt. And this is an instruction especially for interrupt routines. So we can say that it is only executed in the privileged mode or the supervisor mode, not the user mode. And this is the way that we can restore the state of the program after the interrupt has occurred. So it's going to return. And so in the sense, if you're looking at the stack, the supervisor stack, it's going to pop the PC, which is in register 6. And it's going to pop the PSR, which is the state register, right, of the actual system or the processor. And then it's going to branch. So in that case, register 6 is going to be then saved to a location of memory. So you can visualize it like this. So when it generates an interrupt, right, the program counter gets added. Okay, and then the state is going to be here. And so this is the region for your supervisor stack. And so once that's fulfilled, it's going to use the RTI, which is the address for that. It's here. And it's going to put that address or decree and then put that address back to the program counter. And that's where it's going to pick up. And then for 15, what is an internal interrupt? So when you have something that's unexpected in the processor that causes some form of error or exception, then it needs to be handled like an interrupt. So internal interrupt basically is a microprocessor interrupt. And the way that we program this is we want to be able to handle it like an interrupt. We would use a supervisor stack and we would be able to handle it like an interrupt. And it's also the vector that's determined internally by the type of exception. So each exception is different. And you also should note that the priority is the same as the running program, as it is handled like an interrupt service routine. So internal interrupt and interrupt is handled the same way. But the vector for the internal interrupt would specify the type of exception that it's handling. Any question? So in the notes, I give you a little bit more example on how you can use the stack or visualize the stack actually, like how we can add like A, push A in, push B, and then add them together, and then push C and push D, add them, and then multiply, right? Because we add inside the parentheses first and then multiply on the outside, and then we pop the result. So the purpose for this is, why do we care about using the stack? It is because we only have 8 general registers and sometimes your computation can be complex. So we would use a region of memory that's dedicated as a stack to be able to handle your subroutines. And then also example on how you can create stack for op-add or the program itself. We'll look at the example in the lab so you can see how that can be correlated to your project as well. Okay. So there are many ways or many things that we can apply stack. I think using stack is going to be able to help you understand what the compiler does. And when you write a function, now you understand what's happening with the compiler when it executes your function. Okay. All right, any question? So I recommend that you go through, take a look at the notes, take a look at LC3 code, review this, look at some example so that way you can understand. Okay, no problem. All right, any question regarding the assignment? Okay, no question. All right, what I'm gonna do next is I'm gonna talk about your project. I wanna give you time to finish the project on time, okay? I will not accept late project. I think I emphasize this when I talk about the syllabus at the beginning of the course. And I don't make exception for late project. Okay. It is because the reality of things is that when you go to work, it's the project submission is not a thing. Plus, I have to turn in your grade within a certain timeline, and LC3 projects take a while because I read your code and I take a look at your documentation, and I, you know, so there are a lot of different elements in your project, and it's also team evaluation. So I want to make sure that I have enough time to be able to get all my grades in for you so that way you can go through graduation and transfer whatever you need at the end of the semester or move on to the next class. No late final, no late project. So I want to make sure that you have ample time to work on your project as a team. In this class, you will be required to work with other people. At least one more person, I will not accept individual project for this class. Okay. And it is not ideal that you do individual project because you're going to find yourself doing a lot of things and it's very challenging. So team up with someone or a couple other people, maximum 3 person per team. I will not take more than 3 per team. I think that's enough. All right. So let's look at your project. So there are multi-parts to this, okay? You do have the first part that's due the end of May, and then your final product and assessment is gonna come in on June 6th, okay? That's the final exam week. And then I think your finals open until Thursday of that week, so you do have a couple extra days for the final. But I want to make sure, because in the past, I accepted on the last day of the week. And when things come in and missing and things like that, it just created problems. So I want to just make sure the 6th is when we're going to turn in our program and our assessment, so you would see the due date accordingly. So for this project, I want to be able to apply all the learned concept in this class. And there are technical criteria along with documentation and team evaluation that you need to fulfill. So when you take a look at the project, you would see there is a link to a document that shows project criteria. Okay, and so once you click, you can preview this or you can download this. I can download it and show you. So you will need to sign up with your team, right? Probably good to kind of message someone that you want to work with, or you can add yourself to the list and maybe someone will join you. Okay, it's good to communicate with someone. Once you look at the criteria and find the people to work with, right, you can work on solving one option of the listed part. So option A is to do a bubble sort. And I explain what a bubble sort is, right? Basically, when you have these values and you need to test your program, right? You can do an input and output through console, right? I prefer that you will be able to have some user interaction in the program so you can do ASCII conversion and make sure that we're able to handle large digits, okay? So we will talk about how to use array. So here with the bubble sort, basically you take 2 numbers, you compare, right? Which one is lower? The lower one's gonna go into the front, the higher one's gonna go after, and then it's gonna continue with the next 2 number, 33 and 27. Since 27 is less than 33, it's gonna move it to the left, okay? So it's swap place there. Now in programming, you have to think about, because in math, we just say, oh, it's swap place. I take this and move it to the left. Well, before you move it, you got to put it into a location, right? In C++, we would have to make a temp location, take 27, put it there, take 33, move it, and then so you do a triangular move when you do a bubble sort, okay? So when you do a swap, just keep in mind that we have to make sure that data goes to a location and then retrieve it and read from it and bring it back. So we would have a sorted order, okay? So it explains how bubble sort works. Okay, I need to have 8 values, okay? So it needs to store up to 8 values in an array. And the values can be between 0 to 100. So you would ask the user to input values and then sort, and then output the sort value. So the criteria for the technical is that I need to have origination, fill, array, input, and output, 20 points. The sorted values that needs to be displayed. So ASCII conversion is a must, 20 points. I will take a look at how you use your labels and comments, and you do not need to comment every line. Important sections are good. So I will look at that. I will check for your type of instructions, data movement, arithmetic, and conditional. So I will look at branching, you know, add, and then the operational logic as well. You need to have at least 2 sub or more subroutines, so functions. And you need to have subroutine calls, that's 20 points. So at least 2. If you have 1, it will be just 10 points. If that one works. I will also look for branching condition, whether you use it in an if-else statement or a looping mechanism. So conditional or iteration, 30 points. Okay. And you can implement it so many ways. You can do it for to be able to do ASCII conversion and keep looping until, you know, you saw that in some example in the notes. Or you can do other things. We need to manage overflow and storage allocation. So 20 points. 20 points for stack. I need to see push pop operations. And so I will look for TOS. And also, I want to check for underflow and overflow there too. I need to see save and restore register. So 30 points, either in the function or somewhere in your program. Some team in the past, they did all registers for arrays. Some team in the past, they only did a couple register. However, you think that's suitable for your program. We will talk about pointer in the next couple of weeks. So I want to implement that as part of the requirement. So you will be required to use pointer, not stack pointer, pointer in your program. I will check for ASCII conversion, whether you use decimal, hexadecimal offset. We will need to have ASCII conversion as we have input and output. And then in general, I will look for directives, right? So I want you to be able to test your program. You don't have to use the specific values, but I want you to be able to document that you test the program. Okay. And we need to sort it ascending order from small to high. So that's the bubble sort. This is a very popular choice as it's easy to visualize. Another one is to do a test score calculator in assembly. Okay. And you need to ask the user to input their score. I need for you to display the maximum, the minimum, and the average score and the letter grade. Okay. Equivalent. and I give you the range. You're going to have the same criteria as the other one. You're expected to have origination fill, array, input, and output. You need to make sure it outputs the appropriate information. Right? Labels, comments. I will need to look for your instructions, at least two functions or subroutine and function calls. We will need to implement branch for looping and conditions. We will need to control storage and check for underflow, overflow, also with stack operation and regular. We did a lab where we actually used different fill addresses for overflow, so you should know how to do that. We need to include save, restore operations. We also need to use pointer, ASCII conversion, directives, and testing. Okay. This is also a very popular option. Option C is character counter. You would ask the user to input their name, full name, first and last. And it needs to output the numerical value that represent the frequency of the character of their full name. So I would prompt the user to enter their full name. I would ask them to select a character that they want to check for frequency, right? That's just an option. But you can display all the characters, or I would prompt for, like, you know, let's say a letter E, and be able to check how frequent the E comes up in their name. This one usually is not a popular choice, but I really think that's a lot simpler than a lot of people, what people perceive. So, okay. So look at the frequency of a certain character of their name. So we need to take a look at ASCII value for the letters along with the grade calculator one. And then we would see the same criteria as the other two. So I have a rubric. When I grade your program, I will take a look at, you know, what you fulfill. If there's something missing, automatically those points are not given. And then based on that, that will be the outcome of your project. So that's one part. So in the first part, part one, take a look at the criteria, sign up for your team, that's 20 points, right? You click this and it takes you to my Google Doc. You put your name, right? Your team name, your team members, and put down like what each of one is doing and the option that you want to do, okay? And I will check this after the 28th. So make sure that we think about our team and sign up. And then once we go through, the second part of part one is to do the documentation. This is 80 points. This used to be 100, but I changed it up. So 20 points for your team sign up and task allocation, 80 points for your documentation, and actually simplified this. Okay, give me a second. Let me pull. So you need to use this template to give me the documentation. Okay. In my other classes, I'm a little bit more lenient in this area where I just ask for one page and they need to list. And sometimes I get most of what I want. But what I want you to do is you're going to fill out each of the section. The purpose of your program and your goals. What is it trying to achieve? And what you're trying to achieve through the program? Who are you targeting? Who's your user? And then your scope. What's the intention of this program? Right? So if I'm doing a frequency for the character, I would specify that. Or the bubble sort. And then, if you have any kind of references in LC3, so this part, you can just say reference LC3 simulator documentation and so on. the product perspective, take the part where you list the program goal and expand on it and add it here. The data type that you're working with, are you working with values, grade, letters, names, etc.? Talk about that. Here, you need to give me the functionality of the program. A little bit more detail. Don't just put one sentence here. Okay. So ideally, summarize your pseudocode in this part. But don't put the pseudocode here. Give me like an overall brief technical view on what are your functions, what are your subtasks, what is it doing at one point, right? But not like the pseudocode. Just give me a summarized version of that. So if you have in reality, in a regular documentation for application, you have to talk about like, oh, who, which user you interview and how are they involved in the process? Was there any business? So if it's not applied, put NA. Then tell me, how should I use your program? What kind of operating system am I running it on, right? And in this class, we use Windows and we can use the online simulator. So you need to talk about that. And then your development platform, how you, what you use to write your code and how you test your code. I am a type of person that I do focus a lot of this on limitation and constraint because I want to see if you understand the capability of your program and what it can, what areas it can be improved. So make sure you note this. So look at the constraint. What are some of the limitations in your program, right? Because it shows that you test your program and you understand your program. Okay. And if you know of any kind of improvement, you need to note that there. If you have any kind of dependency for the application, you need to note that here, assumption and dependency. So if my program is dependent on a browser, then I need to note and what type of browser that I need to use. As you know, the developer, they develop for a specific browser or a certain application on top of another application. So make sure that we note that there. We understand that this can be ran on an online simulator, what type of online simulator, and then also Windows simulator, right? So how is the user interfacing the program? Are there specific hardware interface? Are there a certain computer type or terminal type? And for in our case, because it's through console, so you probably just the user just require a computer, right? Windows or a computer that's connected to the internet that has mouse, I mean, a keyboard and a monitor, basically. That's what you would note. If there's any additional software interface outside of your OS, you would put that there. If there's none, just put NA. If it needs to be connected to the internet, you need to specify that. Okay, here we are going to break down and describe the functions. Again, do not just put the pseudocode. Tell me what functions and how, what are the goal in each of the functions. Okay, like ASCII conversion, whatever, right? And what's the purpose? You might have a sort function or you might have a grade average function, whatever. Where are your inputs? Where are your outputs? What kind of data are you handling? And you can even mention storage, like container, if you like. What's the performance requirement expected? Is the program... So I want you to take a look from the lens of the worst case scenario, right? Now, as you know, the search and sort algorithm, a lot of the times there's always something, you know, so if you can take a look at how your, what kind of implementation that you have, if you're doing the sort mechanism, And in the case of you doing the other programs, you have to take a look at your performance. If you're using loops, basically it's linear and that's just O of N. So it's going to be dependent on, you know, each of the loop performance. Okay, so it depends on your algorithm and what's your expected performance level. Is it fast, ideal? Can it be improved? And then I need a flow chart or a pseudocode here, okay? And you can use Draw.io or another application and then add the image here. Ideally, I would recommend using an online tool instead of using Microsoft Word. But if you for the pseudocode, if you've never done pseudocode before, I think I put a link on there, right? Put it in plain English, go from the start to the end, but I need to see, you know, if you have subroutine, if you have branching, that needs to be included. But it should outline your entire program, including loops, condition, and everything. Okay, but do not take your code and put it here. Okay, if I see that, that just doesn't count. Okay, the reason why I'm doing this is some of you are going to get senior software engineering project courses. Their documentation, they're going to expect like 12 to 25 pages. So you have to be a little bit more detail oriented, right? Leaving the associate degree and being preparing for the university. And then when you go into engineering or other areas, it's the same. Expectation for documentation is very important. Okay. Any question? So again, part one, team sign up and this. Okay. And I'll be happy to take a look at something and give you some feedback before it's due. That's fine. If you want to, you can drop it in message or email or talk to me and we'll take a look at it. And I'll give you some of the feedback and what can be improved. However, I will not fix your code for you. I can give you some recommendation on what, where to look. But, you know, if you run into problems, I can tell you possibly some area that you can address. Okay. All right. Next part. So take a look at the rubric for part one. Okay. So in part one for the 20 points, post a discussion here. Okay. When you click on this link, it'll take you to the Google Doc once again, and that's where you can find. But you need to add what option you're doing, what makes you a good teammate, how do you communicate in your team. And this is a way for me to help you find your team members, because I know sometimes online classes are difficult to really identify. So go through the discussion and identify the people you want to work with if you haven't figure out who you want to work with yet. Okay. Okay. Part two, which is going to be your files. So I need the LC3. And you don't have to zip it. You can submit it as a .asm. That's fine. Okay. So I will download it and run your program. And if you take a look at the document in the part one, you will also see the same requirements. So decide on the option. So I need the ASM file. And I need your testing. Okay. You need to give me some form of evidence that you tested your program. Now, all else, let's say that you got your program to work somewhat, submit what you have. Because if you don't, you will get a zero here and it will drop your grade by at least a letter grade. So make sure that we submit what we have. And everyone needs to submit, everyone in the team. Okay, don't expect your team member to submit for you, right? All parts, everyone needs to submit, because I will not, right, ask your team members who's in their team. I will use the document to give you the points that you sign up for team. But I want you to contribute, at least submit your part, all the parts in your project, okay? Because in the past, I've gotten students saying that, oh, you know, so-and-so was supposed to submit my part. No, everyone submit. Okay. All right. So part two, the code. And if you haven't used GitHub, start early. Okay. I get a lot of feedback from all the projects in my classes. They always talk about, oh, GitHub is a lot more complicated than it seems. Make sure that you have a README file, and README file is HTML formatted. So I don't want just like, you know, I want it to look professional because this is going to be your repo, right? You can have a team repo, but make sure that it looks professional, okay? If you are using a team repo, make sure that you fork it to your account so that way you would have your project for your portfolio. So what are you graded on? Right? 25 points is going to be team evaluation. You will need to evaluate yourself and give yourself grade and then give your team members grade and be honest, right? And put in the comment if someone doesn't do anything. Yeah, don't give them a zero. And I do read this, right? And I will give you feedback on your project. So it takes me a little bit of time. For GitHub, I need you to give me the URL. So upload a document that have a screenshot and the GitHub URL. Okay. Again, a document that has screenshot of your completed assessment and the URL. Okay. A file upload. 25 points for each. Make sure that we test our URL that it works, because I get some GitHub URL that is not active. It's not public. And you know, I click it and it goes into an error page. 404 page cannot be found, right? Okay, so make sure that we open another browser, test the URL to see if it works. And so that's what's expected. So the things that I look for GitHub is a README page, right? It should contain your information of your team, the program information, the date, the author's name. If you look at a professional programmer README page, right? So if I go to documentation of a package and I look at it, it should be like that, right? Who wrote it, when, which version, what is it doing, how should it be used? Not just the title and then a couple sentences about, oh, this program counts letter in your name, right? Who wrote it, right? So I do look at that, okay? So make sure that we include decent information, and then the source code needs to go into the repo. And you can add your documentation on there. And you should be proud of the project that you accomplished, because that's a way that you can showcase it. You can link your GitHub on your resume and be able to showcase your work, okay? Any question? All right. So after that, so again, the 28th is part one due. Okay. And part two and three is going to be on June 6th. So we should manage time accordingly. If you have questions, concern, things like that, make sure that you let me know. Okay, so take a look at your project. Think about what you want to do. Think about who you want to work with, right? Maximum three people per team. And you can work with someone else. And you should hold your team member accountable. You should help each other if you have questions, if you have concern. Put your best attempt forward. Take a look at the lab. Take a look at all the things that we've learned. Right, we did some coding in the lab and in earlier assignments. And then we talk, you know, take a look at the example in your notes. That's going to help you. Okay. Any question? Okay, I'm going to start recording as we're coming to the close now.